Our topic today is alkenes. Alkenes are very important compounds in industry due to the presence of unsaturated double bond. We saw before that carbon atom has two electrons in the 1s orbital, two in the 2s orbital, and two in the p orbital. When carbon atom gains energy, one of the electrons move to the vacant p orbital. Now you will have one electron, single electron in the 2s orbital, and the three other electrons in the p orbital. This is the excited state. So what happens next is the hybridization, and in the hybridization, in that case, when it happens, two p orbitals will be hybridized with the s orbital. So you'll have here three electrons in the sp2 orbital. This two refers to the two electrons that comes from the p orbital. Now for the last p orbital, it will stay in the pz orbital. So those three electrons, sp2 hybridized orbital, can form a sigma bond. And this one electron can form what we call the bi bond. You could see here in this example, each carbon atom forms three sigma bond. Two of them will be between the carbon atom and the two hydrogen atoms, and one sigma bond between the carbon bond, and the second, the last one, the vacant p orbital will form what we call the pi bond. The sigma bond forms due to the head-to-head overlap between the hybridized sp2 orbital. So this is a ps2 orbital, and this sp2 orbital, and this is hybridized orbital as well. While this one is a last unhybridized p orbital, will form the pi bond. In that way, will be side-to-side overlap. The rotation around the double bond is not allowed. This is why what we will see is actually different isomers due to the presence of this double bond. The isomers are those compounds which have the same number of atoms but with different arrangement. We saw before how crude oil is separated into fractions in the fractional distillation column according to the different boiling points. Usually another step takes place called the cracking. So what happens is actually the large hydrocarbons molecules are fed into the steel chamber in here that contains no oxygen. So no combustion will take place, and the large hydrocarbon molecules are heated at high temperature and passed over a catalyst. You will have here a catalyst. This catalyst is called zeolite. This is a 3D structure of the zeolite catalyst, which also called molecular sieve. This consists of silicon, aluminium oxides, which also mixed with some of metals such as titanium, tin, zinc, and other metals. So what happened? We pass the zeolite, we pass the larger hydrocarbons on the zeolite where the cracking will take place. The large hydrocarbon molecules will be cracked into smaller alkane and alkenes molecules, which can be separated according to the boiling point, similar to the fractional distillation that happened in the first stage. You could see here one example of the reaction that can happen during the cracking process, where the can break down into two compounds. One of them is the hexane, and the other compound is the butene. The butene contains double bond, and usually it can be used as a starting material for many products such as plastics. Now moving to the reactions of alkenes. Alkenes reactions are based around the double bond. We said that the double bond make alkenes unsaturated hydrocarbons that can undergo addition reaction and form corresponding saturated compounds. So first the double bond will break, then a formation of two sigma bond between another two atoms or another two compounds will happen. This is what we call addition reaction, and one example of addition reactions is the addition of hydrogen for the alkene. So the addition of hydrogens, and here I have breaking of the double bond of the alkene, will happen in the first step, where the double bond, the pi bond, will break, and the addition of the two hydrogens will occur. One of them will come in, will be added to this carbon atom, and the other one will be added to this carbon atom. Usually, the reaction happens in the presence of nickel as a catalyst. The reaction happens at high temperature, 140 degrees centigrade, and the result is the saturated form of the alkene. In here I have ethane from ethene, And this reaction, we usually use it to convert oils into margarine. The addition of hydrogen, which is called hydrogenation, is very important reaction in industry. The reaction is used to convert unsaturated oils, such as sunflower oil, into partially saturated by breaking some of the double bonds in oil and the addition of two hydrogen atoms, which results in increasing the boiling point of oil and changing it into margarine. Here you could see the schematic representation of the process where vegetable oils are fed into a chamber and passed over hydrogen and a catalyst. The formed margarine are collected back again, and this is the purified product of the vegetable oils. The second reaction of alkene is the addition of steam. The reaction of steam, water vapor, and the gaseous alkene in presence of concentrated phosphoric acid as a catalyst at a temperature of around 300 degrees centigrade to 330 degrees centigrade and atmospheric pressure between 60 and 70 atmosphere results in the formation of ethanol. This process, the transfer of ethene into ethanol, is not used in industry. Instead, the ethanol is obtained in industry from the fermentation of glucose. The third reaction is the addition of hydrogen halides. In the addition of hydrogen halides, alkenes are bubbled through concentrated solution of hydrogen halide at room temperature. And the result is the addition of hydrogen to one of the carbon atoms. And the bromine atom to the second carbon atom. If I started with something like propene, you could see that I will have two products. One of them will be a minor product, where the hydrogen atom will be added to the this carbon atom, and the bromine atom will be added to this carbon atom. And the major product, where I will have here the addition of the bromine atom, and in here I will have the addition of the hydrogen atom. The addition of hydrogen halides follows what we call Markovnikov's rule. The Markovnikov's rule states that in case of addition of hydrogen halides, the hydrogen is added to the carbon that holds the larger number of hydrogens, and the bromine are added to the carbon which has a lower number of hydrogens. Let's understand the reasons behind the Markovnikov's rule. Now, if I start with something like propene, in that case I have CH3, CH, double bond CH2, which is the propene. If I add HBr, first the propene will act as a nucleophile, which will attack my electrophile, and in here you could see that the hydrogen bromide, the hydrogen will have a partially positive charge, and the bromine will have a partially negative charge with those three lone pairs. So the double bond will attack the hydrogen, forming an intermediate. In that case, the intermediate will be CH3, and this carbon will carry the positive charge, plus the bromine ion, negative bromine ion. Now, if I add when the double bond attacks the hydrogen and the hydrogen is added to my compound, if I add it to this carbon instead, you could see in that case I will have CH3, CH2, bond CH2, and I will have the positive charge on this carbon atom. You could see, and I have here a primary carbon cation, where here I have a secondary carbon cation. The secondary carbon cation is much more stable than the primary carbon cation. This is why I will have the addition of the hydrogen to the this carbon atom, which is my major intermediate, comparing to the addition of the hydrogen to that carbon atom, where I will have here the minor intermediate. This is a slow step that is followed by another step where my bromine ion, the negative bromine ion that formed in the first step, will act now as a nucleophile that will attack my compound, my carbon cation, which is the in that case will be the electrophile. So now the bromine will attack this carbon atom, and I will have my major product, which is CH3CHBr, and here I will have CH3. You have here the formid 2-bromo-probane. The 2-bromo-probane is my major product. It doesn't mean that I will not form as a 1-bromo-probane. I will have it as a minor product where I will have the CH3CH2CH2Br, which is the 1-bromo-probane. Now, moving to the addition of halogens, in that case, when the double bond breaks, each carbon atom of the double bond will, one bromine atom or one halide will be added to this, to each carbon atom. So if I started with something like ethene, I will have 1 and 2 dibromo ethane. The reaction of halides with the alkenes is used to detect for the presence of unsaturated compounds. You could see that if I started with something that, like bromine water, if I use the alkanes, nothing happens. But if I use the alkenes such as hexene with bromine water, the color will disappear. And this disappear the disappearance of the color of the bromine water indicates the presence of the double bond. Now, if I looked at the reaction mechanism of the electrophilic addition of bromine to ethene, in here I will have the BrBr, where I will have here partially positive charge, and here I will have partially negative charge. This is due to the induced dipole forces that allow for one of the bromine atom to withdraw electrons towards itself. So the double bond will attack the bromine atom that carries the positive charge, and a bond will form between the carbon and the bromine. The second bromine, which will be a negative ion in that case, will act now as nucleophile to attack the carbon atom that carries the positive charge, which is the carbon cation. And I will have the bromine, the 2-bromine atoms, case of a bond will form, a sigma bond will form, and I will have the product 1 and 2 dibromo ethane. Now, moving to the oxidation reaction of alkenes, usually potassium permanganate is used, and it is a very interesting reaction because it relies on the concentration of the potassium permanganate. If it is concentrated, a complete breaking of the sigma and the bi bond will happen, but if it is diluted, only the bi bond will break. Now let's start with the acidified potassium permanganate solution, and in here I will have the diluted potassium permanganate. So the double bond will break, the bi bond, and the addition of hydroxyl group will happen for each carbon atom. Now moving to the hot concentrated potassium permanganate, in that case, like we said before, a post bond, the sigma bond, and the bi bond will break. So I can have, if the double bond was between the two end of the carbon atoms, in that case, I will have carbon dioxide that will be produced. But if I have a carbon atom which bonded to one hydrogen and one alkyl group, in that case, I will have aldehyde, and this aldehyde will further oxidize to form carboxylic acid. If I have the carbon atom bonded to two alkyl groups, in that case, what will happen is the formation of a ketone. Now let's look at this example. In here I have 2-methylpropyl-1-ene. You could see that the double bond at the end of this compound, and I have this carbon atom which is attached to two hydrogens, and here this carbon is attached to alkyl group. So the carbon which is attached to two methyl groups will form the ketone, and this carbon atom will form the carbon dioxide. Now moving to the addition polymerization reaction, which is used in the formation of plastics. Usually you start with the small units of monomers that are linked together in a chain to form polymers. For example, you start with 10,000 ethene monomers bonded together to form a polymer chain of polyethene, which is used in plastic bags. So in here you could see this the ethene, and what you will form is a polyethene, which you will have this N, and this N is you can replace it by the number of units of the monomers that added to form my polymer. So the double bond breaks, and instead I will have the addition of multiple monomers linked together. You could see as a result of that, the starting materials are monomers, which are unsaturated compounds, but the result is a stable saturated polymers. Moving to another polymer compound, which is very important in industry, in the plastic industry, the polyvinyl alcohol. The starting material of polyvinyl alcohol is a chloroethene. Start with the chloroethene, where I have this carbon atom attached to two hydrogens, and this carbon atom is attached to one hydrogen and one chlorine atom. The double bond breaks, and a chain of monomers bonded together to form the polychloroethene. Also, the importance of plastics, they introduce a problem associated with plastic disposal. Remember, we break the double bond to form repeated units of longer chains, which makes the formed polymer compounds less reactive and less susceptible to chemical attack, which makes their degradation and decomposition takes hundreds of years. One method is used to dispose of plastic, which is burning the polyalkenes and use the energy in electricity generation. But still, the large amount of carbon dioxide is produced, and if incomplete combustion happens, carcinogenous toxic organic fumes are produced. And even polychloroethane cannot be disposed by using this method due to the toxic dioxins, which are formed, which is very hard to dispose of and very toxic compounds.